4.2 million people die each year as a result of having to breathe in polluted air that's been churned out by industry, agriculture, and transport. 92% of the global population live in areas where pollution exceeds limits that are safe for humans. In fact, right here, right now, in my hometown of Bristol, we can see real-time air quality data. And currently, in the middle of the day, levels of nitrogen dioxide, just one pollutant, currently exceed quite comfortably the levels set by the World Health Organization to try to protect people. We're currently at 76 micrograms per meters cubed. Now, we all know that something needs to be done about this. The chances are that you probably already ride a bike if you're watching this video, and so you are already taking steps to try to reduce pollution. But are those steps actually putting yourself further into harm's way? Because where we ride, it feels like we're right in the firing line, breathing in fumes straight out the back of vehicles, and big lungfuls as well, because we're doing exercise at the same time. So in this video, we are going to explore just what it means to live and ride in our polluted cities and find out, very simply, if it's actually safe to do so.
In many cases, it isn't a very visible issue.
What's interesting about air pollution is that it really attacks practically every organ of our body.
I'm not entirely sure I know exactly what air pollution is. So to find out more, we're off to meet Ender Hayes, Professor of Air Quality and Carbon Management.
So very simply, first of all, what are the different types of pollution that affect us cyclists when we're out riding in the city?
Okay, so air pollution naturally exists in the atmosphere anyway. But what we've seen in recent years is that human activities are obviously increasing those levels. So the most traditional pollutants that we would be exposed to, particularly in urban environments, are things like nitrogen dioxide, things like particulate matter, which is very, very fine particles of various sizes, and then things like sulfur dioxide, ozone, and then you start to move into things like heavy metals, etc. But it all depends on which sources you're looking at. So from transport, nitrogen dioxide and particulates matter, PM10 and PM2.5, are our most shall we say, problematic pollutants. But if you're looking at agriculture, it could be something like ammonia. If you're looking at waste systems, it could be something like particulate. So it varies depending on which sources you're looking at. But they're the main issues that we deal with.
You mentioned nitrogen dioxide. What actually is that?
So nitrogen dioxide is a gas which is generated by the combustion of fuel within the engine. Predominantly, it is released from the tailpipe as nitrogen oxides. It goes into the atmosphere, you get a chemical reaction, and nitrogen dioxide is created. And it is nitrogen dioxide that we have health-based limit values for. So it's quite simply a gas from combustion. The other main source of pollution from road transport is particulate matter. Particulate matter can be generated from the combustion of fuel as well, like nitrogen dioxide, but it can also be generated from brake wear and from tire wear. So, you know, it's a particle, it's a fine particle. Some older vehicles where you see that big belch of pollution coming out the back of it, it's pollution that you're seeing coming out of it. And then if you manage to ever get outside the city and look over the city on a cold morning, you may see this kind of brown hazy layer, or even this grey hazy layer sitting over the city. And then that's the buildup of all the pollution in the city being quite visible to the human eye. In many cases, it isn't a very visible issue, unless you see that belch. It isn't something that people connect to on a day-to-day basis.
Kalais, I mean, how much does particulate matter spread from, you know, a busy road to the surrounding streets, and likewise nitrogen dioxide?
They can move, and they can move quite a distance. I don't know, you may not recall, but in recent years we've had pollution events here in the UK that have been influenced by biomass burning in Eastern Europe, that have been influenced by Saharan dust storms. So that particulate matter is being generated at the far side of Europe, yet is still being picked up and is still being carried over. So you do get particulate matter that comes from other sources outside the city. But you're right, you also get particulate matter which is generated inside the city and can move around different environments. What does happen is that you do see, particularly for nitrogen dioxide, you do see a drop off in concentrations the further you are from the road. So if the roadside is here, and if we say the facade of a building is 10 or 15 meters back, then you do see a substantial drop off in concentrations over that distance. Transport is going to be your predominant issue. So in a city, you have background pollution levels. So these are our background levels that are made up by a number of different contributing factors, and indeed pollution that is blown in from outside the city. You then have your very, very local sources. So if you're stopped at a junction, then it is predominantly the traffic around you and the effect that they can have on you. So it is going to be cars, buses, HGVs, taxis, all those different transport sources around you. And it's also then the fact that they're located at busy junctions, they're turning over, then they're all accelerating and decelerating as they move towards the junction. You as a cyclist, you're in the middle of that mix.
So if those are the pollutants, what exactly are they doing to us? Well, there is, unfortunately, a huge amount of evidence to tell us exactly what. Air pollution is linked to cardiac problems like heart disease and stroke. It reduces lung function in adults and suppresses lung growth in children. It causes asthma and is a known cause of cancer. It is strongly correlated with the onset of type 2 diabetes, dementia, and is even connected to impaired brain development in children and brain function in adults. So, suboptimal then. However, the complex thing about researching air pollution and its effects is that it seems hard to prove the direct consequences on a case-by-case basis, which has left researchers vulnerable to powerful lobby groups from industry, transport, and agriculture. However, when you look at large-scale examples that cover many thousands, even millions of people, incredibly compelling patterns emerge. Take, for example, the London smog event of 1952, in which an estimated 12,000 people died from a wide range of illnesses as a result. Some fairly scary health implications then. It's not something that I think about all the time, but I certainly do when I'm on my bike, breathing in great lungfuls of air from a particularly smoky bus, for example. But while we know that there are health implications to everyone, to the wider population, what we don't yet know is whether it's actually any worse for us cyclists. So we need to speak to someone and find out. Take a deep breath. We're off to see someone at the forefront of the research. Dr. Audrey de Nazel of Imperial College London. Of most relevance to us, co-author of Can Air Pollution Negate the Health Benefits of Cycling and Walking?
So what's interesting about air pollution is that it really attacks practically every organ of our body, and it affects us throughout every stages of our lives, right? From when we're in our mother's womb, it can have an impact on low birth weight, or on preterm birth. As we grow and develop our lungs, it can impede our lung growth. It can also have impacts on our development of our brain. And then it can have impacts on our cardiovascular system, respiratory system. We even know that air pollution has impact on diabetes. And lately, we've seen increasing information on air pollution having impacts on obesity. So as you can see, it's just a huge, or lung cancer is, of course, another big one. So really, it affects, as I say, practically every organ of our body. So should we ride a bike in the city? Well, the answer is overwhelmingly yes. Why would you be concerned about riding a bike in the city? Because we know that air pollution, as we just said, is terrible for you. And of course, if you cycle, you put yourself in a very highly polluted environment. Transportation environments tend to be the highest polluted environment that we go through in our daily lives. And if you cycle, not only are you right in the street where it's highly polluted, but because you're physically active, you're inhaling at a high inhalation rate, and so you intake more air pollution than, of course, if you were staying at home, or even if you were in a car. So if you were in a car, you might have higher concentration within your car, but because on a bicycle you're physically active, your total intake of air pollution ends up being higher. Well, we've looked at this question from various perspectives. We did some modeling studies, some simulation studies, and some epidemiological analysis, some experimental analysis to try to understand what are the risks and benefits of cycling in cities. And in most of the evidence that we can see so far, the answer is clearly the benefits of physical activity outweigh the risks of air pollution. Now, this is true in most parts of the world, but then if you start going to places like Delhi or Beijing, then it's safe to cycle for maybe an hour and a half. And beyond that, probably the levels of air pollution are so high there that you probably are better staying at home beyond an hour and a half. But in the conditions that we get in most parts of the world, there seems to be clear indications that at least for healthy adults, in the long run, you're getting much more benefit from the physical activity than the hard harm from air pollution. If you increase your intensity of exercise, you're also, in most cases, benefiting more from the physical activity. So yes, you're going to be inhaling more air pollution by having higher intensity, but you're also going to get better physical activity. So the balancing out and the risks and benefits are probably about the same, but I think we can't provide an answer right now on what is the optimal intensity of your cycling habit to make the most out of it.
A relief then to know that the health benefits unequivocally outweigh the negative effects of pollution. But are there any practical steps we can take though to reduce those negative aspects even more?
The good thing is that there are lots of things you can do, well not, there are a few things you can do to mitigate the impacts of air pollution when you cycle in the city. The first thing is to use back streets. You can reduce your air pollution exposure by 30 to 50% by taking back streets, by taking streets that don't have as much traffic. So that's the most obvious thing, using back streets. There are also time of the day, if you have any flexibility, the time of the day that you go out, just avoid rush hour, because that's where you'll find the highest levels of air pollution. People often ask me about masks. I think masks will remove some particulate matter. It won't remove any of the gases. It'll remove some of the particulate matter, not all. But I think it will make cycling so uncomfortable that personally, I think it's not worth it. Yes, it will remove some, but not everything. I think it's not my personal choice because it's just too, if for it to work, for the mask to work, they have to be super snug and make sure that you don't get any air that comes in. And a mask that is that snug is just really uncomfortable. So that's the issue with it. And what air pollution does is actually increase inflammation in your body. So by taking fruits and vegetables, by having, by not being stressed, by having a balanced diet in general, resting, enough sleep, all these things help against the negative impacts of air pollution.
Well, from now on, I am going to take the long way to work, and if I'm late, I'll simply say that I've been forced to dodge air pollution. In all seriousness though, it is incredibly reassuring to think that when we ride our bikes, we are still doing far more good than harm, even on the busiest city streets, as well as doing good for the wider community as well. Because cycling is one of the best ways in which we can begin to reduce air pollution. I mean, take a look at this graph, for example, from Professor Joe Wood. It illustrates data taken from a point in central London. The grey line represents the average amount of oxides of nitrogen that were detected in the atmosphere over the course of the day on any given Sunday. The red lines, however, refer to the amount of oxides of nitrogen on days in which motor vehicles were entirely replaced by bikes, because actually the roads were shut to cars because it was the Ride London Sportif. Now, the results are utterly remarkable, clearly an extreme example, but Professor Ender Hayes was also enthusiastic about the effect that bikes can have.
Anything that involves getting us out of our cars, getting us on bikes, walking, public transport, whatever it might be, is going to have a positive effect. Certainly, I'm a cyclist. I cycle and commute on a morning basis. And it comes down to the choices we make. I own a car, but I'm also a cyclist. So my car is currently at home, sitting on my drive, and not being used, because I made the decision to get on my bike and to use the train. So it comes down to the choices we make, and it comes down to the behaviors and the day-to-day practices and activities that we might want to implement. But certainly anything we can do to get the numbers of cars off the road is only going to have a positive effect on air pollution in our cities, and indeed a positive effect on our public health.
So get out there, enjoy riding your bike, do good for your own health and for that of the environment. And if you need one last fact to spur you on, remember this. Research has shown that pollution levels inside your car are actually significantly worse than those outside. So, I will not be needing this, but your average car driver just might.